I'm delighted that you've joined us today for these racial justice lightning talks. They feature so many distinguished alumni, students, faculty, and friends of the Holder Initiative from a wide range of fields and disciplines, including the arts, medicine, education, bill disruption, and more generally, social justice. Before we begin, I would like to encourage you to join us also for upcoming Holder Initiative events this year. The first one will be a panel that will take place on Thursday, this coming Thursday, October 8th. It's going to be part of our American Voter Project, and it'll be on the 2020 elections. And it will feature, in addition to Attorney General Eric Holder, Vanita Gupta, who is the president and CEO of the Leadership Conference on Civil and Human Rights, Eugene Robinson, who is associate editor and columnist at the Washington Post, and Nate Silver, founder and editor-in-chief of 538. So now what I'd like to do is introduce Beth Manchester, who is the associate director of the Holder Initiative and who has thought up and produced these remarkable lightning talks. And she's gonna take it over and give you an overview of the afternoon. Welcome again.
Hi, thank you so much, Professor Harcourt. Again, my name is Beth Manchester. I'm the Associate Director of the Holder Initiative. We're so thrilled to have you here for our first foray into lightning talks today on the theme of social justice and in particular, racial justice. Given this moment in time, it's a vitally important question for all of us to be having and conversations to be having and to be looking at it from many different angles. So we're so thrilled to have the amazing lineup of speakers that we have. Again, to echo Professor Harcourt, we feel so lucky to have so many really active and passionate alumni and students and faculty and friends who are willing to engage in these talks with us. Just a couple of housekeeping notes. Really, it's just actually one housekeeping note. We did encourage you to submit questions beforehand, but of course you will be welcome to submit questions through the Q&A box as ideas percolate while you're listening to our speakers. So first, if he's ready, we're running a tiny bit early. I would love to welcome our artist in residence, Christopher P. Wolfe. And I will read his bio for you. It's pretty impressive, so get ready. Christopher Wolfe, he's a graduate of the School of the Arts in Creative Writing as a fiction concentrator in 2018. And he's our inaugural artist in residence. Chris graduated from the United States Military Academy, also known as West Point, in 2000, and served as a field artillery officer in the US Army for 6 years. He's a veteran of Operation Iraqi Freedom and was awarded the Bronze Star Medal for meritorious service in a combat zone. After completing military service, Chris earned his MBA with a concentration in investment finance from Duke University's Fuqua School of Business and worked on Wall Street as an investment banker during the height of the financial crisis. After 5 years on Wall Street, Chris earned his MFA. So after an MBA, he thought he'd go for a change. He earned his MFA from Columbia University in creative writing as a fiction concentrator. And at Columbia, he was an instructor for the Columbia Veterans Creative Writing Workshop and was selected for the School of the Arts Teaching Fellowship. Chris currently teaches creative writing at Rikers Island to incarcerated students as part of Columbia University's Justice and Education Initiative. His writing has been featured in The Bomb Magazine, Guernica, The New York Times Magazine, and two anthologies, including The Road Ahead, Fiction from the Forever War, and The Kiss, Intimacies from Writers. In addition to serving as our artist in residence, Chris has been appointed as an adjunct assistant professor in Columbia University's School of the Arts Writing Program. And it should also be noted that he teaches a wonderful seminar through the undergraduate creative writing department to Columbia College General Studies, Barnard, and C students. And with that, I would love to welcome Chris Wolfe.
Thank you so much for that introduction and for organizing this event today. I'd also like to thank all of you who have tuned in for this very important conversation. As the artist in residence, I'd like to use my time to communicate to you through my artistic medium. So I'm going to be sharing an essay that I wrote over this past summer. The title of this essay is the most beautifulest thing in this world. The most beautifulest thing in this world is just like this. Standing at the corner of Amsterdam in 120 something, we waited for the lurking white man in the crosswalk signal to grant us permission to move about our business. When he appeared, we continued our journey away from Columbia's campus, catching between blocks glimpses of Morningside Park as we headed towards parts of Harlem less occupied by New Age settlers, known for displacing the natives and Giulianing the homeless. This was the second or third time I had seen you since you'd gotten out. You looked healthy and calm, flashing a smile I didn't see often when you were a student in my writing class on the inside. We've been planning this link up for a minute. You will be seeing me, Professor. You have said a number of times throughout the semester. However, when I first started teaching with the program, I had been forewarned that only a few students would come to campus and continue taking classes once released. I was forewarned about the many factors determining the path of the formerly incarcerated: financial support, familial stability, struggles with addiction, whether or not an employer could see beyond the label to the person standing in front of them. It was an apt warning. At least two of the guys in our class were back in jail before our semester ended. A few others, when they were released, went down paths to which I'm not privy. But to be honest, I still look for them. And then there's you. You showed up on campus. You continued taking classes. Your word was your bond. And so here we were, walking in Harlem. We were headed to your place of employment, an invitation I hadn't expected, but appreciated as it gave me a chance to see you enjoy what we both had longed for, your freedom. I remember the first time I read you more clearly than the first time I met you. Your voice on the page had a poignant clarity and a vulnerability that cut through the noise. I'm 22 years old and this is my first and last time serving time, is a line that comes to my mind. In class, you often sat quiet, thumb and index finger contemplatively twisting your dreads as if your mind was in another place. And I wouldn't have blamed you if that was the case. But at any given moment, you were subject to open your mouth and so improved that you had been listening intently, bringing the crux of the matter into sharper focus. We kept moving north into Harlem, passing corner stores and bodegas when you received head nods and pounds from Black men from around that way. You told me how strange it was to come down to Columbia and be surrounded by white folks and resources in abundance, then go back home to see young Black men and women with too few good options and too many negative consequences. You pulled your cell phone from your pocket and showed me a picture of your close friends, pointing out the ones that had been locked up since the photograph was taken. It didn't seem that there was a face you left untouched. Listening to you, I couldn't help but conjure in my mind the same dangerous dichotomy running rife throughout our country's history. Anemic, resource-starved communities of color, sitting if not adjacent, then in close proximity to flourishing white neighborhoods as if part of some cruel joke. As you talked, I saw the many Black and brown faces in our classes at the jail versus the scattered few in the classes I've taught on Columbia's campus. As you talked, I recalled my Bed-Stuy block, how during the financial crisis, streets of cracked up asphalt and potholes so big they reminded me of bombed out Iraqi airstrips were suddenly paved clean over pristine pipes, bringing in new utilities as Black households were being pushed out. I remember the trip I took down to New Orleans to visit my brother after I got back from Iraq, how he drove me down to the Garden District and we stood in the street median, pivoting to see broken down, dilapidated houses comprising the Black neighborhood on one side, juxtaposed with white-owned multi-story Victorians propped up on the other. how are our kids ever going to aspire to have anything when this is what they see generation after generation? He pondered as we surveyed our surroundings. I never asked and never will. But as we kept walking, for some reason, you told me the charges that led to your incarceration. You hesitated mid-sentence and said that you didn't want this revelation to change the way I saw you. I assured you it wouldn't. How could it when, stepping into my fourth decade, I've seen too many times how clearly the line separating the free and incarcerated is one made malleable by money, power, and privilege. How could it when I repeatedly walked jail hallways, seeing the walls swell with black bodies as if America has deemed it part of our natural progression? It's a sight that saddens, sobers, and arrests you in a way that no essay or intellectual exercise can or should. How could it, after I saw our incarcerated cohort, myself included, spend months in that classroom showing each other more civility, mutual respect, and empathy than you'd find in a New York City subway car? How could it change my view of you when in you I see clearly the memories of my youth? Memories filled with young brothers who smoked dope, some who sold coke, stuffed crack vials down tube socks on a mission to never go broke. We were black kids who knew the taste of a butter sandwich, had felt the weight of government cheese. Born into the cycle, our anger at the world left unleashed. We were mean mugged and scruffed up. Some of us had been cuffed up. But regardless of who we were in that moment, we could never forget the kids we had once been. Black boys with beautiful black smiles before we were cloaked in sin. Black boys who grew into black men. Black men who came to understand that we faced a system designed to have us acting like corralled crabs, clipping and clawing at each other's limbs. Black men working to dismantle the bigoted system that put us in the barrel in the first place. We kept walking. You kept smiling. We turned east and headed toward Adam Clayton Powell. In the middle of the block, we stopped in front of what I assumed to be a public school building, given its limestone and brick facade, in tall, metal, yet still scalable fence. You led me inside and introduced me to your colleagues at the office of an advocacy organization that supports court-involved youth. You took me upstairs to where classes were being held, and young kids of color canvassed the hallways, carrying beautiful smiles I recognized. At each stop, someone offered praise for the work you were doing and the time and talent you were pouring into the community. After touring the building, we walked back downstairs. Curbside, I listened as you detailed your goals and aspirations, your dreams of getting into social work. You said that you could see yourself working with at-risk youth. You would recognize your ability to connect with them. We quickly talked up a straw man for how you could accomplish this before you gave me a pound and went on your way. Many months have passed since that day, months in which we've been in and out of touch for a number of reasons. A lost loved one, a lost cell phone, reconnecting with lost motors. In that time, I've taught another semester at the jail. I stood in a dimly lit visitor center, head bowed at the incarcerated students' request in a moment of silence for Tessa Majors before I presented their college certificates. In that time, I stopped by your work and left a copy of Angela Davis' autobiography on your desk. I got your text confirming that you received it. In that time, the virus hit the city, shutting down everything, including educational programs on the inside. In that time, we lost Brianna, Ahmad, George, and Rashad. In that time, I've been enraged that it takes 8 minutes and 46 seconds of torture for white people to reckon with the racist system that they know black folks have been dealing with for generations. In that time, I found out about Elijah, adding more kindling to the fire. In that time, I revisited a piece I published over a year ago in the New York Times, titled, "Sorry, I Never Thought I'd See the Day I'd Be Working for a Colored Officer." It's the piece that you and the guys used to jokingly ask me to autograph. I never told you this, but days after publishing it, I received a number of congratulatory phone calls and emails, a few mistakenly stating that I was a patriot, the best this country has to offer. I also received a message from a friend and mentor honing in on a paragraph I had written. It read, "As a Black veteran, I find it hard to reconcile my pride in my service with the sense of complicity in upholding my country's legacy of white supremacy while deployed. I still remember the black and brown faces of Iraqis I helped to round up, zip tie, and detain using tactics similar to stop and frisk, the use of which some courts have in America have found to be unconstitutional. These experiences created a moral chasm with which I continue to grapple." Of this paragraph, my mentor asked, "How were you complicit? And if given a chance to reconcile, what would that look like?" I delayed answering these questions for weeks, ruminating, better yet evading the necessary reflection to come up with this answer. I believe that I was complicit by allowing myself to reach a point where I devalued and allowed others to devalue the life of Iraq citizens in the same way that people of color have been and still are devalued in this country. I look back on those black and brown faces of detained Iraqis often. I see the Humvee headlights shining onto their hooded heads and blinded eyes. I hear the heavy metal guitar riffs blaring to keep them awake through the night. And I see me not doing a damn thing to stop it. This past February, I visited LA to reconnect with some guys with whom I served. Together, we rehashed other similar moments that we experienced. And at one point, one of us said, "I wonder whatever happened to those guys." For a salient moment, we sat in silence. I come to believe that the reason I find it hard to reconcile this experience is that it cannot be reconciled. The tension that exists within me from my service in Iraq will persist because it is something I should live with. It is the humbling Janus head that enables me to see that you and so many of the incarcerated women and men I've encountered are and will be leaders that our community needs. That your voices and perspectives, now that the white power structure appears to be listening, are the ones that need to be heard. This irreconcilable tension is what keeps me coming back inside the jail, not to educate you, but to be educated by you. An education that I wasn't ready to receive during my adolescent years, occupying Black Baptist church pews. One I couldn't receive at West Point, nor while obtaining two master degrees. One I would never receive working on Wall Street. It's an education that's required me to be stirred by the words of Robert Wright and to seek counsel from the likes of Jay Holder, to learn my craft from Mitch Jackson, and to be a better advocate from Jarrell Daniels. It is an education of the soul, one that has helped me to see that the most beautiful thing in this world is our collective freedom, the freedom from America's reckless oppression, freedom from her nonchalant knees on our necks, freedom to forgive, to evolve, to learn, to love. It is our freedom to come back home from our darkest place and for our remaining days, live life to its fullest. Weeks ago, I was standing in a massive line of masked patrons that stretched the full length of the BJ's parking lot in Queens. Suddenly, I felt my cell phone ringing in my pocket. I answered it, and it was a collect call from a student at the jail's women's facility. I began rambling, aware that the 20-minute countdown on our call had begun. Before we were disconnected, I asked her if there was anything she needed, anything that I or the program could do for her. Her response before the call abruptly ended was to send more paper so she could keep working. Thank you.
Chris, thank you so much for sharing that beautiful reading. So thoughtful and deeply personal. And we really, really do appreciate it. It's always funny in the beginning of Q&A, typically no one has questions. And then once the floodgates open, it's like, we don't have time for all the questions. In any case, I will go ahead and get started during this time of people reflecting to think about how to form their questions. One of the things that we've talked a lot about, you know, in terms of your piece in the New York Times, is thinking about this confusing position of being with someone, right? Like your white sergeant, who, you know, in that piece, it never seemed to me like he was a villain or a bad guy, even though he said this deeply offensive thing that you really had to stop and ruminate before you could even begin to try to respond to him in any way. And it's something that we talked about in terms of the work you did on A Soldier's Play, thinking about how do you engage in conversation someone who has such a completely different orientation than yours, whose thoughts and statements and actions are informed by their upbringing, right? Mm-hmm. By their environment. And still these things come off as deeply offensive to you. So how do you navigate that tension between dealing with someone who isn't inherently bad, but their situation and their environment and their upbringing has caused them to have, you know, a problematic worldview as we seek to live in a world that is more fair, that's willing to admit that we have these systemic issues of inequality that need to be addressed. I don't know if you can parse through what I was trying to get to there, but.
Yeah, no, I think so, Beth. I mean, what I would say is that I think part of having the conversation is just acknowledging how difficult it is to have the conversation. Right? Because I think one of the ways that racism is able to persist is because it's a difficult conversation to have. It requires vulnerability, right? And no one wants to say the wrong thing and be kind of X'd out of someone else's life and you know, walk around with an inability to reconcile. But you know, the challenge is that, you know, the very point that you made, we all come with a certain life experience that shapes the way we see the world. And we have acquired different language for how to describe our experience. And, you know, I think that what I try to do is, again, just acknowledge that it's difficult to have this conversation, that we come with a different vocabulary and a different analysis in life experience. And, you know, I often recommend and invite individuals to go to, I know that there are a number of organizations that offer undoing racism, anti-racism workshops throughout the city and places where we can acquire a common language and a common analysis so we can begin to unpack and speak on our personal experience. And, you know, I think through those types of interactions, a lot can be achieved. There can be a space where there is an ability to make yourself vulnerable, to have a meaningful conversation that enables one to express all that they have experienced in how they see the world and somehow break down these barriers of communication that are just they're inherent. Like it, to me, in my opinion, that's one of the ways that, you know, racism is able to persist. It's just so hard to talk about and you know, it requires having more spaces that enable that degree of vulnerability.
Thank you so much. We have a teeny bit more time, so I'd also love to ask you about, you know, what motivated you to write your essay and to also have the stamina to return to it, because I know it's so wonderful to write something and then put it away in a drawer and forget about it and never touch it again. And clearly, given the timely references, this is something that you are continuing to work on and have quite recently. So So I guess I was just hoping you could share a bit about your evolving thoughts about your experience teaching this student in particular.
Sure.
And what you're thinking about now in the moment that we find ourselves in.
Sure. You know, what I'll say is, you know, Beth, you and I have had many opportunities to speak. And so, you know, that I've studied with Paul Beatty, who won the Man Booker a few years ago for writing a book called The Sellout. And something that he impressed upon me is the importance of what he calls thunderstruck moments. You know, those moments that stay with you and you know, they just kind of linger in your mind. And at times you're able to look back at them and just pull from them. Sometimes they speak to your value system. Sometimes they speak to, you know, your beliefs. And you know, I think that's where that was the germ of the piece that I published in the New York Times Magazine about that, you know, the white sergeant that worked for me in Iraq when he, you know, said that he never thought he'd see the day that he'd be working for a colored officer. And that's also the source of this piece. So this was a student who, he was in the first semester that I taught at Rikers. And he was one of the first students that he told me throughout the semester that, you know, I'm gonna be seeing you. And sure enough, he showed up on campus at Columbia, and you know, it was just so exciting to meet with him. And one day he offered to, you know, just have, you know, take a walk with me. He said, "Hey, you know, won't you walk with me up to my job?" And you know, we went for a walk and just had just such a deep, meaningful conversation. And I was able to just learn more about him and you know, just have a, you know, just a little bit of a view into his, a little bit better view into his life. And it was just something that continued. It was one of those thunderstruck moments that I often look back on, like, man, we walked for blocks, you know, we, you know, I should have had on a pair of Timberlands or something, because we really moved through Harlem. And, you know, again, as I have looked back on that walk, and, you know, just wondering what was so special about it and just unpacked it. You know, it just, you know, the things that I mentioned in the article, you know, just, you know, him kind of communicating his experience at Columbia and causing me to reflect on, you know, my experience growing up and in the South and my time living here in New York and, you know, what I have observed and have, you know, come to understand are, you know, just some of the ways that race, the construct of race and racism has played out in terms of, you know, resources for certain neighborhoods and certain schools and just how it plays out in how it's played out in both of our life experience. And, you know, it was just, again, it was just something that it was a span of time that stayed with me. And as I began to unpack it on the page, you know, it's something that came to me during the months of, I think, May was when I started work. Actually, it was June when I started working on it. And, you know, I was just trying to process a lot of what was going on in the world at that time, and that's still going on, you know, with losing Breonna Taylor and Ahmaud and George Floyd. And, you know, for a while I didn't want to speak on it. You know, it was hard for me to speak on it because I think I was just, you know, processing it and trying to understand and at the same time, just, you know, angry, just going through a lot of emotions. And, you know, my younger brother, I have a younger brother who's in the Coast Guard. He said, "Well, you know, Chris, you're a writer, you need to write." And, you know, part of me was like, you know what? I hear you, but I just need to just be and feel.
I definitely said that too. I'm sorry for being so impatient. I was like, Chris has so much to say about this.
Yeah, we did have conversations, and you know,
I understand your thoughtfulness and process, and wanting to make sure that what you're putting out into the world is what you really want to say, and what you really believe, and how you're moving the conversation forward, and not just taking up oxygen.
Right, and you know, once I started working on the piece, you know, I just, you know, it just kind of came together, and the connections were there, and you know, just going through the, you know, my usual writing process of writing and revising and, you know, rereading and you know, sending it to, you know, my group of trusted readers. And, you know, the piece kind of came together.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Chris, for your time and generosity today. We're so excited to be continuing working with you all year on other Holder projects. So please, everyone on the webinar and anyone who is watching this via Facebook, please do join us for future events with Chris and other people working in the arts and justice space. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Beth. It was a pleasure to be here today.
Thank you. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Gary C. Butts. He is a proud Columbia College alumnus from the class of 1976. He's currently the Executive Vice President for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion at Mount Sinai Healthcare Systems. He is a visionary leader with more than 20 years experience in designing, developing, and managing diversity, equity, and inclusion programs and strategies in executive level healthcare. Since 2014, he has been Chief Diversity and Inclusion Officer for the Mount Sinai Health System and Dean for Diversity Programs, Policy, and Community Affairs for the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai. These roles and responsibilities have evolved substantially since he was recruited to design, develop, and lead diversity and inclusion organizational structure and programs for the medical school in 1998. Dr. Butts has overseen the development of one of the nation's, if not the world's, most comprehensive, full thickness and impactful DEI programs for a healthcare system. In these roles, Dr. Butts is responsible for oversight management and integration of all aspects of diversity programs and policies for the Mount Sinai Health System to ensure diversity and inclusion as an integral core institutional value and resource across the health system, including the medical and graduate schools, graduate medical education, and the entire hospital system with its 41,000 employees. Dr. Butts is the leading senior representative and voice for diversity deans and leaders in New York to the Associate Medical Schools of New York. Since 2006, as chair of the Committee on Diversity and Multicultural Affairs, he has mentored dozens of leaders in diversity and inclusion for medical schools and health systems. In 2019, he co-founded the Diversity Innovation Hub, a Mount Sinai venture, which he directs. A first for healthcare systems, the DHI intentionally intersects priorities of diversity and inclusion with innovation and technology, addressing the lack of inclusion of women and people of color in the health innovation and technology space by expanding the diversity and capacity of entrepreneurs with tech and innovation pipelines, targeting high school, college, and medical students and resident trainees. Dr. Butts holds joint appointments as professor with tenure in the departments of pediatrics, medical education, and environmental medicine and public health. Under his tenure, the medical school and health system have been recognized annually by Higher Education Excellence in Diversity, the Human Rights Campaign for LGBTQ Inclusion and Quality Care by the Diversity Inc. for the top 10 hospitals and health systems for four consecutive years, achieving the number one ranking in 2017 and 2018. In addition, Mount Sinai Health System has achieved status as Forbes' top 20 employers for diversity in the nation in 2018 and 2019. And Diversity Innovation Hub was awarded the Rock Health Diversity Innovations Award in 2020. As EVP, Dr. Butts works directly with the Mount Sinai Health System President and CEO and is a key member of the executive team. Thank you for putting up with me while I read that incredibly impressive bio. Thank you as I stumbled through it, but truly, Dr. Butts, we are so thrilled to have you here. And thank you so much for making the time to share your insights, your educational, your personal, professional insights particularly, you know, in terms of healthcare, which I think we all agree could be improved upon in our country. So I hand it off to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I'm hoping you can all hear me.
Great. Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. Let me before I move forward, and my remarks will be relatively brief, but Christopher, I want to just thank you for setting up the moment for me, because you are quite right. It is, the struggles, particularly as they're highlighted today, are difficult to think about and even more difficult to talk about, particularly for those of us who've had no option but to be the recipients of, so much of the inequity, and based sometimes purely on the color of us. Because I thank you for setting me up, and hopefully my remarks will be even more grounded as I share a little bit about me and look back, take advantage of this rare opportunity to look back kind of from where I started as I think forward. And so I want to thank you all, Beth and team, for inviting me to share a little bit in this moment and about the moment from my perch in health and health care. This is particularly important to me as Eric Holder and I did cross paths a few times a number of years ago. Both in the 60s, we both went to Stuyvesant High School, and in the 70s, we found ourselves at Columbia. He was a number of years in front of me. By way of very brief background, I am a native New Yorker. You don't become even more, any more New York than being from Brooklyn, and I'm a product of East New York, Brooklyn, and I'm also still a proud Yankee fan. I can say that even more proudly today, and hopefully I can say the same thing next week as the season moves forward. Now, while many of you might not think that the geographic distance between East New York, Brooklyn, and Columbia, and where I am today, working at Mount Sinai, is a big one. Clearly, these past 50, 60 years have presented an incredibly rich and valuable path for me developmentally regarding my personal and professional growth. But I'm often reminded of what it was like and the context in which I grew up and developed to where I am today. As I think back to growing up in poor, segregated East New York or Brooklyn, and just last night in talking with a medical student mentee, I had an opportunity to share with him, what the differences were then and how we define and understand poverty and the tough circumstances that people of color exist and still compared to what they were then. And I'm reminded of how much colder the cold nights, winter nights were growing up than they are now. But the unfortunate reality is that, these continue to be relatively routine experiences for far too many people, poor people, people of color, and our newer immigrants. A little bit more about me. As I said, I am a product of Stuyvesant High School. I got there by chance. And my mom didn't know, that it was important to take that exam. That's how, out of the loop we were as a family. But it was a friend's parent that insisted on that exam. And so that was the beginning of somewhat of a leap from Brooklyn to Manhattan. And then from there, I went on to Columbia despite the discouragement. And even at Columbia, and as I was finishing up at Stuyvesant in the early 70s, I was discouraged from coming to Columbia because, largely because of the riots and some of the civil unrest on the campus before I got there, that Eric Holder was in part a participant. And so, you know, as I think back to my days at Columbia, it's only in looking back when you can appreciate, you know, the importance of that foundation and the so many ways that we sometimes don't have a chance to think about, both as relates to personal and professional development and the networks that began as early as in college. And so, for example, one of my closest friends, who I thought was pre-med, ended up in chemistry, and he's now the president of Xavier University in Louisiana. And we continue to talk and share notes. And he might have a question or so about what to do and how to, whether a policy makes sense during this pandemic or not. And of course, I call upon him to get a better perspective in where students are as they think about medicine and research for careers. So now almost 50 years later, with this rare opportunity to reflect, I think the good news, at least for me, has been that I, despite the odds, have had a career path fully committed to addressing inequities in social justice in health and in healthcare, with a focus on healthcare access and opportunity access. So, for example, I've spent 30 plus years as a primary care doc from the Mount Sinai platform and serving children and families from Central Harlem and East Harlem primarily. I was given the opportunity and the privilege to work as a deputy commissioner for the city health department, the largest local health department in the world. And then I've spent the past 20 plus years working on diversity and equity issues, primarily in the medical school and more recently for the largest healthcare system in New York City. Okay. The challenges we face and racial justice are that much more in our face today as the clear lights are shining on what's been an unfortunate recurring reality regarding racial inequity and injustice. Let me share just a little bit about what my observations and what I have learned. So number one, racism, and Christopher, thank you for being sharing that square in the face for us, because we've got to talk about not just race, but racism, okay? And it is a key underpinning to many of the struggles that we continue to be at and try to, as we try to advance issues of diversity, equity, and inclusion. Number two, structural and systemic racism does not spare the healthcare system. We are not immune as physicians and leaders in healthcare systems from these tough, longstanding issues. And how are they manifest for those of us in health and healthcare? You know, you see and hear about these pretty regularly. It is responsible for delays and differential access to screening and treatment for COVID. It is responsible for the unequal access to preventive measures. We know that PPE still is not as easily available in communities of color, and frankly, even in some of the city hospitals to the degree that it's been elsewhere. It is responsible for the disparities and what we have already witnessed and outcomes from the pandemic. It is responsible in part for the unequal uptake and the benefit from innovations in healthcare, like healthcare technology, telehealth, telemedicine. It is responsible for the uneven burden for students of color, for poor students on college campuses like that of Columbia. It is responsible in part for the disproportionate impact of this pandemic on our communities of color, including small businesses. It is responsible in part for the uneven impact of education and readiness for children of color and for poor families. And it is responsible, unfortunately, for the lack of diverse participation in the vaccine trials. We don't have diversity in those trials. We will never know what the benefits could be of the vaccine once it's available for our communities of color, nor the benefits from this and the emerging therapeutics to address COVID-19. That said, this is an important moment in our history to leverage this opportunity, the attention to these tough issues, but it will require all of us, not just some of us, all of us, just like it did during the civil rights movement. So what's next? I think, again, back to Christopher's point, we have to uncover and address racism head on. This will require a long, deep dive for enduring solutions. But also it is important that we are prepared to address some of the more critical, urgent issues in the moment, okay? So as we heal, we find the time to heal, and that still is important. And I think you can hear some of us are going through more than others. But while we heal, it's important to listen, particularly to those who've been largely invisible, so that their voices are heard. We can understand what success looks like for everyone, not just for those of us who are privileged to lead in these efforts. It is important that we learn with each other and through each other to become comfortable being uncomfortable in this space. It is important to activate allies because it will require all of us. It is important that we are positioned to advocate when the moment comes as necessary. And then it is important that we measure and celebrate both our successes and communicate them across our communities and then some. Thank you for hearing me out and sharing a little bit about me and some of my perspectives based on the privilege that I've had and walking this path over the past almost 50 years now. And I end with the question, if not now, in this moment, then when? And so I'll stop there and I'll entertain any questions that might be out there from the audience. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, Dr. Butts, for that wonderful talk. We really appreciate your insight during this really peculiar moment. We are running a little over time, but we have a couple of questions, and I would really like to pose one if you don't mind. And one question that an audience member asked was, what are some key next steps in the medical field to address racism? Given your insight and expertise, what you think, the best realistic but vital next steps would be?
I think first, as I alluded to, first is, we have to first call it out, call it what it is, mm-hmm. right? And to Christopher's point, right? If we don't call it out for what it is, then there's nothing to address. Right? And then clearly, let's try to figure out how racism plays an important key underpinning to so much of what we've been trying to address in diversity, equity, and inclusion. Now, we've done pretty well in our healthcare system, and lots of ways that are measurable regarding impact, okay? But none of that will be truly successful unless we are very clear about the underpinning that needs to be addressed. So that's part one. And as a part of that, we had to become comfortable being uncomfortable, right? And those folk, and trust me, this is not an easy conversation for me, just like for Christopher, that's mm-hmm. the point. But can you imagine then how tough it is for other people who haven't been in this space, right? So those are really important, I think, foundational things that have to be done. And then it's important to line up in a relatively smart way what the priorities would be based on the evidence that's available to us, either through anecdote or data, okay? And then, arrange those priorities in a way where we can go deep and long, right? Because, I think the urgency often is to fix things, right? These are not issues you can fix overnight. That's just not the way we get there, right? And so it will require patience, bringing people together in ways that perhaps we've not had the opportunity to do in the past, with executive leadership, folk who don't look like us, and agree that now is the time. Okay? And then we can begin to line up some of the old existing programs and newly emerging ones to make the difference. We can't get there without inclusion of folk in the conversation and in important spaces for higher education like what exists at Columbia.
Great. Thank you so much for leaving us on this note of having to get down to hard work, but hopefulness and working all together during this period and forever, hopefully. Again, thank you so much, Dr. Butts, for joining us. We're so appreciative that you took the time on this, what looks like a beautiful Saturday from inside my apartment, at least. So thank you so much, sir. We really appreciate it.
Thanks so much for having me.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Chris Correa. Chris is the Data and Product Development Manager at the Bail Project. Chris has over a decade of experience leading data infrastructure, data modeling, and statistical and machine learning initiatives. A New England native, he earned a BA at Hampshire College, an MS at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, and was a doctoral candidate at the University of Michigan. Chris is dedicated to advocating data-informed public policy that upholds human dignity. And in addition to all of those things, he also has been the wonderful manager and partner of the internships that the Holder Initiative has been supporting all last summer, and we're continuing through the fall on an amazing data storytelling project. And with that, I would like to welcome Chris.
Well, I want to thank you all for inviting me to this space. And I thought that for this time, I'd like to talk a little bit about the Bail Project, talk about the work we're doing, talk about the role of data and technology in decarceration and combating inequities, and then really celebrate some of the great work our Holder Initiative partners are helping with. We have some really talented students that we're working with this year. On any given night in America, over 500,000 people are sitting behind bars and over 3,000 jails across the country, even though these people haven't been convicted or sentenced of a crime. Now, many of these individuals are detained in these jails because they can't afford to pay the bail amount set to secure their release. So while some people are booked into jail and can pay their way out through their own personal funds or their family funds, others are stuck. Sometimes for bail amounts of just hundreds or a few thousand dollars. So this two-tiered system criminalizes poverty, and it's a structural linchpin of mass incarceration and racial inequality in our criminal justice system. Dr. Budd said that structural racism does not spare the healthcare system. It certainly does not spare the criminal justice system. People who are jailed pretrial will typically wait months and sometimes years for their cases to resolve. And during this time, when they're caged, they're pressured to plead guilty. They can lose their jobs, their homes, and critical ties to their families and community. So there's an enormous human toll of this crisis, and it's levied almost exclusively on the poor and disproportionately on communities of color. And all this exists and is justified because of a theory that when people risk their own money to post bail, they'll be motivated to come back to court. So that's where the Bail Project comes in. The Bail Project is a national revolving bail fund. And over the past 2.5 years, we've opened sites in 24 communities across the country. And the staff at each site will pay bail for individuals who can't afford to post their own bail. Now, the clients don't pay anything. So we're challenging the very premise of the money bail system because our clients' money is not on the line. Now, when our clients go to their required court hearings and their case is closed, the bail money is returned to the organization. And so when that money's back in the Bail Project account, it's used to pay someone else's bail across the country, and so on and so on. And that's why we call it the National Revolving Bail Fund model. It's just one tool, one approach to fight against the racial and economic disparities in the bail system. Now, Black and brown people make up 2/3 of our clients. and our average bail posting is just over $2,000. But for most of our clients, a few thousand dollars might represent a month or two of income or more. And since 2018, we've posted bail and secured the freedom for over 12,000 people. Now, when our clients' cases close, we found out that 92% of them are not sentenced to any additional time in jail or any prison sentence. It's 92%. So these individuals were being jailed in a pretrial setting for allegations that either ended up being resulting in dismissal or an acquittal or a guilty plea that wasn't deemed serious enough to justify any additional jail time. So the case for cash bail is a very weak case, but we spend a lot of our time thinking about what comes next. What comes after cash bail? How do we shift resources away from jails and other forms of supervision and toward long-term investments that are grounded in equity and actually make communities safer? But in fact, many alternatives to incarceration will leverage data and technology to create new forms of supervision or recreate existing inequities. So one example is a risk assessment algorithm. So these are tools that will weakly predict an individual's risk of not returning to court based on historical data that's woven with systemic exclusion and discrimination. Another example that we frequently confront is electronic monitoring or GPS monitoring. So across many of our sites, there's a growing use of GPS monitoring for people waiting for trial. And while it's true that having an ankle bracelet and being at home is usually less harmful than sitting in a jail, clients do risk traumatizing rearrest if the technology fails, they lose a signal, the battery dies, or if they unknowingly pass through some restricted geographic zone on their way to see family or go to work. And for the privilege of being monitored in this way, our clients are being billed hundreds of dollars each month in service fees, plus 10% interest if they fall behind on any of their payments. So many of these technology solutions are promoted or perceived as being more objective or more humane than jail. But we know that new technologies can frequently create new forms of dehumanizing supervision in ways that often reflect and reproduce existing inequities. So that's a question that drives much of my work with the Bell Project is how do we leverage technology and data to support individuals rather than supervise them? And this is where the Holder Initiative team comes in because we brought on thanks to the support from the Holder Initiative, some talented students who are studying computer science but have a passion for social justice. And one of the particular challenges these interns are helping us face is this. If our clients miss a scheduled court appearance, the judge can issue a warrant and detain that person for the length of the trial so they can be sent back to jail. And what we've discovered is that most people who do miss a court appearance are not trying to avoid the law. They're not in the run. More oftentimes, they have trouble getting themselves to court in time, particularly if public transportation infrastructure is lacking in their neighborhood. Or they may be hospitalized or in a residential treatment center, or they may simply forget or become confused about court processes. And this confusion has been especially troubling during the pandemic, when courts have been closing and reopening and rescheduling in all kinds of creative ways. So one of the supports we provide as an organization is court date reminders. We'll try to reach out to clients and be clear about when they're required to be to court and help them navigate any obstacles they have. But we have thousands of clients right now with open cases, and we have about 45 staff members who we call bail disruptors who are trying to serve these clients. And so to say the least, it can be overwhelming to track down these court dates when they're constantly changing. So one of our interns has learned to build a software program to automatically scrape the upcoming court hearing dates and times from public court sites so that we can run this program weekly on a regular basis and learn about all the new court hearings that have been scheduled for our clients and communicate accurate information to the people we serve. So that's one small example of supporting people through technology and not supervising them. Now, we send these court reminders, these court date reminders to our clients through an automatic text messaging program. So on a typical weekday morning, we'll send hundreds of these court reminders and we'll get all kinds of responses back. Now, most of the responses are simply confirming that the message has been received or confirming that the client will appear in court as scheduled. But other responses reflect the challenges that our clients are facing and a lot of the obstacles that might prevent them from returning to court. So one of the projects our Holder Initiative interns are assisting with is to learn to leverage natural language processing technologies to automatically classify these text message responses from clients so that we can quickly understand and address any requests for assistance. So for example, if somebody replies back to the message and indicates that they don't have a way to get to court, we can forward that response to a support staff member who will then coordinate rideshare to help that person get to court on time. Or if the client indicates they're facing some kind of crisis, for example, like a housing issue, we can forward that response to a client support specialist who is able to follow up and connect the client to community resources. So that's another example of like what I call using technology to support and not supervise. These court reminders are completely voluntary. The client responses are voluntary. We don't require anything of our clients. We simply try to make ourselves available and as responsive as we can to help them navigate the system. So we're very grateful for the support from the Holder Initiative and the amazing interns who are helping keep people free. I think there's great promise in decarceration, but the looming question is what comes next. And so when money bail is eliminated, and I do think over time it will be eliminated in most communities, will we choose to fall back on supervisory technologies and algorithms that reinforce the racial biases that are lurking around so many corners of the legal system in America? Or do we choose another path, thinking about how we as a society can respond to harm and invest in alternatives to incarceration that are designed to support people rather than supervise people in ways that reflect and reproduce existing inequities? So again, we're really grateful for the support from the Holder Initiative and for the talented students who we're working with this summer and fall. And if we have time, Beth, I'd be happy to answer any questions I can.
Thank you so much, Chris. We are running a little over time, and you actually answered, I think, a looming question, with all the sources of data we have available to us. And all of the advances in technology, I think, a natural question is how do you make an algorithm fair? And so we're so encouraged to hear the ways in which you are addressing that question when we think about how algorithms kind of are, at least existing ones seem like they could be inherently biased, the ways in which you're trying to think differently about how you're constructing the algorithms and the data you receive.
Yeah, well,
I also was a creative writing major, so I don't know if that statement made sense, but I think it might have.
I mean, I guess what I'll just say in response to that, though, Beth, is that, like, to be clear, if an algorithm is really data informed, there is no technical fix for it. There's no way to fix an algorithm that's based on historical data that's woven with these inequities. And so that's something that we really try to do our best to communicate, that there's no technical fix for the problem if the algorithms are based on the problems of the past rather than the problems of the future.
Great. Thank you so much, Chris. We really appreciate your taking the time today and the time you've taken all summer and fall to work with our interns, because we know that they are so passionate and they're learning so much from you and your team. So thank you so much for the opportunity and your partnership.
Thank you.
Thanks again to Chris. And our next speaker is Brian Sarfo, Columbia College 2017. Brian is a current 2L at Fordham Law School. I'm hailing from the Bronx. Brian completed his BA at Columbia College in 2017 in urban studies and a concentration in African American studies. Brian then went on to earn his master's in education for the University of Pennsylvania in 2019. Before law school, Brian taught high school world history in Chicago and coached basketball and track and field. Brian's hopes to use his legal education to equip disenfranchised and marginalized communities with tools for self-sufficiency, self-governance, and defense. Coupled with this, Brian would love to amplify the voices of the unheard and disregarded in society. At Fordham Law, Brian serves as the Community Service Chair of BLSA and as the Director of the Student Representation Project. Brian is also a Fordham Professionalism Fellow and the Furyk Center for Social Justice, Amanda Rose Lauren Education Law Fellow. Brian is also a member of the Education Law Collaborative, Dispute Resolution Society, and Moot Court. Outside of Fordham Law, Brian is the Advocacy and External Initiatives Chairperson for Northeast BLSA, and he's also an instructor at Columbia's Double Discovery Center and is building the curriculum and teaching a wonderful class for high school students around civic engagement. So welcome, Brian. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Beth, for the introduction. Brian Sarfo, Fordham, proud graduate of Columbia College, class of 2017. And I have the privilege currently to serve as an instructor at the Double Discovery Center, which basically empowers low-income first-generation students through after-school enrichment programs, as well as tutoring and a host of other resources and programming that I've had the privilege to participate in throughout my career at Columbia. So working with the Roger LaHecca Double Discovery Center has been an absolute privilege and has been sort of formative in my growth as an individual and the work that I've pursued since leaving Columbia, almost basically influencing my decision to go into education. Before I discuss the work that I'm doing currently in the role as an instructor in this virtual Zoom digital age that we all find ourselves in, I had the chance to tutor through the Double Discovery Center. I had the chance to serve as a teaching assistant and live in Carmen, the freshman dorms, with many of the high school students and serve as a resource for them in that capacity. And I also was an instructor right before I went to law school, where I taught a course on political sort of discourse in the age of Trump and thinking about cultural transformations, history, and social movements, and really connecting with the students on a level and having them engage with the discourse that sort of the country found itself in at the time, which was in 2017. But something that I think was identified by Dr. Hayes, the current executive director of the Double Discovery Center, and then in conversation with her, we came up with this course in which we're actually collaborating with one of the students that is a part of the Holder Initiative, in which basically we are going to engage students on civic engagement and participation. And data and research shows that many students from the communities that the Double Discovery Center works with often feel like they're not equipped, or they've demonstrated, at least in my interactions with them, that they don't feel empowered actually to get civically engaged. And while they might be aware and well-versed in what is happening in their communities, from just general civic participation, their ability to voice their concerns, and thinking about what that looks like on their level as high school students, they don't feel sort of compelled to do so. And this course is going to explore those elements of representation, participation, and speech, doing a sweep of like social movements from as early as the founding of this country, right? And looking at things such as, the Boston Tea Party, acts of resistance that have always been ingrained in the DNA, even if it may not have been afforded to everyone at the time, there was still, this idea of protest and civic engagement and voicing concerns about things that are not just, and having them look at different points in history in that regard. Having the students engage with voter mobilization, but also voter disenfranchisement, right? Thinking about how for from basically the founding to 1976, when we see 18-year-olds getting the right to vote, you know, and seeing women get the right to vote, seeing Black women, Black men, other individuals from marginalized groups getting those rights to vote, you know, I think students are able to see, like, you know, they can have their voices heard. And even taking a look at voter disenfranchisement of, you know, our recently released prison population, as we think about those who were formerly incarcerated still feeling or still having to deal with deliberate efforts to take away their right as members of society to vote after paying their debt to society. And so these are, you know, some of the topics that we hope to explore in the course. And quite frankly, a lot of that is rooted in, and for me personally, in sort of the civic engagement that I was able to participate in while at Columbia, whether it be engaging in voter mobilization efforts as through voter registration, general just engagement with the general community at large in Harlem, and being able to interact with the members of the community beyond what is Morningside Heights, which I've always considered an extension of Harlem, just so happens to have been renamed over time. But I think, you know, like it's a privilege that the university is situated in such a rich and cultural location. And having grown up in New York City, grown up in the Bronx, I've been able to tap into those connections and my own familiarity with the city to make sure that I'm trying to bring in as many nuggets to engage the students through this course, which will commence starting next week. So I'm definitely looking forward to that. And I think, you know, the double discovery is sometimes, to me, I consider it the hidden gem in Lerner Hall that often people pass by often, but are unfamiliar about the work that is being done on a day-to-day basis. And much like how I got involved as a tutor, I often am pitching to, you know, my peers or people that I've been working with in the mentorship capacity as a mentor, you know, just referring them to the Double Discovery Center and making sure that, you know, we're getting the best students and even members of the general New York community and beyond to really engage and get involved with the work that the center is doing to make sure that students are given equal footing in what we already know is definitely an uneven, unleveled playing field. And so I will always be indebted to the Double Discovery Center as far as just constantly returning back to contribute and help in whatever way possible.
So believe it or not, we're actually only running 1 minute behind, which means I would like to go a tiny bit over and ask you a question. Sure. About the wonderful course you're teaching. You know, I have a sense from your talk and from prior conversations about the learning objectives, but I was wondering about your thoughts about how they take what they learn in the course and then kind of like go forth into their community to really actualize a lot of the lessons learned.
Absolutely. You know, I guess referring back to the work that I did during my master's program, that was grounded in using like reflection as a measure to enhance civic responsibility and how students see themselves. And so I think a lot of that is gonna be having the students grapple with reflecting on what exactly is it that they want, right? And I think we often don't inform high school students that, you know, the problems that they see in front of them are going to be problems that they're going to engage with later on. And so the end goal of this is to have students work on their own campaigns, engage in civil discourse, and not, you know, reflect the debate that we saw a few days ago, in which we saw our, you know, our president and vice president essentially engaging in some uncharacteristic political exchanges and banter that I think is off now starting to trickle into the way in which students engage on things when they disagree with one another. And so creating spaces for students to, you know, agree to disagree and to have like the proper tools to do that, but also identifying things in their community, in their schools, at the Double Discovery Center, right, that they think are worthwhile and need to be changed, and then having them create sort of a plan using the tools that they've learned throughout the course to present to their classmates and potentially to members of the Columbia community at large, and like I said, in the Zoom world, and being able to share those opinions and feel empowered to say, okay, how can I go about making that change now that I have those tools?
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Brian. Yeah, I think we can all agree that to use the word debate to describe what happened on Tuesday evening is doing a disservice to the word debate. So thank you. But yes, thank you so much for all the work you're doing to work with your students to make sure that they're able to really hear each other and be open to other people's viewpoints, because that's really the only way to move forward, I think, to be at least open to hearing an opposing view from your own. So thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us on this beautiful Saturday. And thank you so much for all the amazing work you're doing at Columbia with high school students and in the community in general.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Our next group is a wonderful group of students and faculty who have created a course that they will speak more about in a moment, but I'll just quickly share with you that we'll be hearing from a number of students and faculty who were the force behind this new and innovative seminar called Frontiers of Justice. The mission of this core group of students and faculty is to provide Columbia students with the opportunity to become active change agents within their academic institutions and larger communities. Through education, research, and advocacy, students engage in a weekly seminar designed to focus on a variety of challenges facing New York City residents. Through sharing ideas on how to make structural and systemic change in ways that integrate science, law, politics, narrative, and community engagement, Frontiers of Justice aims to raise political and social awareness, strengthen ties between Columbia University, disadvantaged communities, local governmental agencies, and grassroots organizations. The course culminates in students working collaboratively with attorneys and community representatives to develop jointly authored policy recommendations. And so with that, I'd like to please welcome Jarell Daniels, a current general studies student and key architect of this innovative course, along with several of his peers.
Hello, welcome everyone. I'll just dive right into it. So I consider myself to be a community advocate, a student, and also a future civil rights attorney. And I can honestly say that the person I am today is in large part because of the teenager I never got to be. After serving 6 years in prison, beginning at the age of 18 for a crime I deeply regret, I spent a number of years planning for my return. And towards the near conclusion of my sentence, I stumbled upon a rare opportunity to enroll in a Columbia University course just a few weeks before my release from Queensborough Correctional Facility. The course was taught by psychology professor Geraldine Downey and Manhattan Assistant District Attorney Lucy Lang. It was called Inside Criminal Justice, and that seems pretty straightforward. But it turns out that the class was made up of 16 students, 8 incarcerated men, and 8 assistant district attorneys. And what we learned in class eventually worked its way into concrete policy recommendations. After all of the incarcerated men, including myself, were released, we presented our proposals to the Manhattan District Attorney, the State Department of Corrections Commissioner, and Columbia Trustee Lisa Carno at our graduation ceremony in a packed Columbia auditorium. And after all of these experiences, they have led me to develop the Justice Ambassadors Youth Council at Columbia University, bringing together young New Yorkers, some who already spent time locked up, and others who are still in high school. And together, they join city officials representing various agencies. And in this classroom, everyone is brainstorming ideas about improving the lives of our city's most vulnerable youth before they get trapped within our criminal justice system. But I didn't stop there. After applying for and graciously being accepted into the School of General Studies at Columbia, I was honored to learn from so much brilliant minds, both professors and students. I was honored to be welcomed with resources and opportunities to thrive. But more importantly, I was given the tools to complete my life transformation. I felt valued in a way that encouraged me to explore ways of empowering other young people with true leadership opportunities. This led me to establish the Frontiers of Justice student group. With the help of my Columbia College undergraduate friends, Elena Logani, Kiana Taghavi, Fonda Shane, Ghislaine Pages, and Tyler Campbell, we were able to provide students at Columbia with an opportunity to become active change agents within their academic institutions and the larger community. We partnered with Friends of the Island Academy, Double Discovery, Community Connections for Youth, and many other organizations to explore ways for undergraduates to support their local community efforts. We hope to provide students with an opportunity to alleviate some of the challenges facing New York City's most vulnerable populations. Our ultimate goal was to work with Columbia faculty to translate the students' volunteer experiences and their commitment to racial justice into a social justice themed course that will culminate in final class projects that will reflect the citywide policy recommendations. And today I'm proud to announce that with the help of Caroline Marvin and Professors Ayanna Surrett and Geraldine Downey, we've launched the Frontiers of Justice seminar course with the Psychology and African American Studies departments at Columbia University. But the best part of this is that it actually counts as a science requirement. And what do you think, Kiana?
Yes, definitely. I have to say, with the bureaucracy of the core curriculum, it is wonderful to have this counted. If only it counted for my PE requirement, but oh well. But thank you so much, Jeral, for so kindly sharing all of that and introducing us. I'm so lucky to know all of these people and am forever indebted to the core curriculum, the Center for Justice, and the Holder Initiative for facilitating this connection and such strong friendships. Though Frontiers of Justice was birthed out of a shared hope to streamline justice-centered campus discussions and for a longing to amplify and unite community-based social justice engagements, this group simply came together as people looking to support and uplift one another with the recognition that the indefinable concept of justice is practicable and proximate in all of our daily strides. As Professors Downey and Surrett teach us in class, our personal and public-minded identities are intertwined and nourish each other. So I wanted to emphasize that this web of faculty, staff, and students grounds all of our endeavors in a language of compassion and of care. Frontiers of Justice was originally structured as a weekly meeting between students and faculty affiliated with the Center for Justice. Jeral, our incredible spearhead, led our group in brainstorming ways to synthesize and expand campus conversations on social justice and student activism. We followed both short and long-term approaches in addressing our observations and personal experiences. We compiled a list of justice-oriented classes and campus clubs into a spreadsheet and invited these groups to our lunch meetings as a form of coalition building and mutual support. What became immediately apparent, however, is that an array of student groups and community-based organizations already existed in strong and active capacities and were on the front lines, fighting the good fight. We were so encouraged by this, so naturally we sought to join forces in an effort to amplify these engagements and increase student participation. But at one point, we did ask ourselves and each other, what was holding public-minded students back from fully immersing in these opportunities? I think one of our conclusions was that with a well-resourced institution like Columbia, it is really easy to feel overwhelmed and confused in terms of where to go to explore a budding interest or how to have conversations with community leaders and organizers in a productive way. There was already so much being done both within and outside the Columbia community across all levels and realms, but it seemed like at the end of the day, students will always return to their classes, their schoolwork, and the ongoing discussions circulating throughout campus spaces. We began to think critically about justice-centered education. So we launched a series of panels in Columbia University courses to explore ways that the discipline in question, whether it be the humanities or STEM, could be used for the advancement of public service. In October of 2019, Frontiers of Justice was invited to present at an introductory neuroscience course, a common undergrad class that many pre-med students are required to take. The panel was composed of a variety of people. We had a lecturer and a researcher from Columbia Law, an alum interested in the intersection of death penalty abolition and neuroscience, a current student speaking about how the arts are a tool for liberation and inclusive education, and of course, our one and only Jarrell Daniels speaking to the transformative power of collaborative education. We discussed how the study of science, especially the science of the brain, can be leveraged to address and respond to questions of justice. We ended the panel by asking all students to respond to a note card with a pre-printed question. What does justice look like? We collected the responses, and to merely express our gratitude and admiration for them would be an understatement. The pursuit of justice, though practicable, is something that demands constant learning. In December, our working group culminated in a dinner reception as a formal launch to Frontiers of Justice. We are still so grateful to the Holder Initiative, who made this evening possible. As undergraduate students, community organizers, city agency members, and a lot of other people met for a night of conversation, meditation, and mobilization. This is a moment in time when this course is particularly important. In fall of 2019, in our planning stages, we did not anticipate the fraction of the uncertainty, grief, and unrest this year would bring us. So with that, I will pass it on to Alina, into a celebratory cheers to the very fitting Frontiers of Justice seminar. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kiana. Hi, I joined the crew of Frontiers last fall when I ran into my very dear friends, Kiana and Jarrell, for the first time in that behavioral neuroscience course that Kiana was mentioning. I actually met them in that panel that they held. And I was enamored immediately with the ways in which they talked about justice. It wasn't theoretical and it wasn't an intangible ideal to strive towards. Rather, it was very real, very community oriented, and very much within our reach as students and activists. And as a team, the conversations that we keep coming back to, and what I found myself learning and relearning time and again in my own community activism and involvement, is that education, far more than a way to make connections, provide a secure financial future, or even help us grow intellectually, is a tool. In fact, I think our crew would call it the single greatest tool for engendering community change that our society has. Education is the tool that allows disempowered and marginalized communities to magnify their own voices, call out injustice, and drive political change. Education is the same tool that allows those in positions of privilege to recognize and acknowledge that privilege, and being able to use it to redirect the resources that they have so much claim to, whether that be educationally, financially, or politically. I've seen this firsthand for years. I come from a family of immigrants. For years, I've been teaching ESL, English as a Second Language, classes in the communities I was a part of, whether in Atlanta, in my now home of Spokane, Washington, or most recently in New York. ESL classes gave my community members the linguistic tools they needed to advocate for themselves and their rights, both in the workplace and within their own schools. Interestingly, where I haven't seen education used as such a tool was, remarkably, in the institution we now find ourselves living and learning and working within. We currently occupy a campus that has an incredible array of resources, financially, academically, in the realm of research, and in the sheer number of political and economic connections it has. Our core curriculum is meant to help students, and I quote, develop principles of personal and social responsibility for living in a diverse world. Yet the conversations we have in class often fall short of this goal. Students know that structures of oppression in today's society are a problem, and they know how to speak and write eloquently about such problems. But at the end of the day, very few leave equipped with the political tools or the knowledge with how to begin addressing and fixing such problems. Kiana mentioned the array of student groups that we have on campus that we admire greatly, who are attempting to address the issues that society presents us with. But even as we admire the work they do, we have to ask ourselves, why is it that the vast majority of these groups end up only meeting once or twice a semester? Why do we have four separate groups working towards addressing the same aspect of immigrants' rights or environmental justice or housing inequity when their resources, connections, and volunteer pools would be 10 times as effective if they joined forces? What we've had to confront is that for every group actively meeting and engendering change, there are at least 10 others that call themselves justice-oriented but do not know how to actually push for change. Our academic resources ultimately have been pointed inwards to generate individuals that know how to talk amongst themselves about the systemic issues in their society, but are equipped to do very little more than just talk about these issues. And that's where we found Frontiers of Justice, you know, playing a pivotal role in filling that gap. This class was designed with the explicit goal of education-oriented justice in mind. We asked ourselves, why isn't there something on campus that brings people together from the diverse array of backgrounds that we have within Columbia's sphere to work together across our differences to solve community challenges? How can we redirect the wealth of our academic resources from pointing inwards to pointing out into the communities that Columbia lives alongside and among? How do we equip students with the tools and the connections to become active change agents instead of passive ones? The answer, for us at least, lied in bringing together students from all disciplines and backgrounds and across all of Columbia's schools into one room, or at least for now, one Zoom meeting, alongside lawyers and community leaders. We figured, hey, we have the resources of not just Columbia University, but the rest of New York at our disposal. Why not combine the two to push for maximum collaboration and change? So our course is in its fourth week now, with students from the School of Engineering, the college, from GS, from the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, as well as lawyers and community activists, many of whom received their education in prison. Jarell and Kiana are both students in the course. I have the immense privilege of TAing it. And we've designed our curriculum to address both of the goals that we discussed today: educating students about the nuances of the issues that residents of New York and broader America face, as well as Columbia's own role in perpetuating these issues, from Columbia's ties to New York's prisons, to the school-to-prison pipeline, to housing inequities, medical apartheid, and environmental racism, among many, many other issues. Throughout the semester, we have almost weekly guest lecturers who are community experts in their respective fields on the issues being discussed. The course culminates in policy proposals, which are very similar to what Jarell spoke about earlier. And these policy proposals are jointly offered by the students, lawyers, and community leaders in the class. We end, as always, this semester with action, showing students how to take the knowledge and tools that their education provides them with and redirecting it to make change. And I know that I, for one, as well as Kiana and Jarell, are endlessly excited to see how our students take their ideas and proposals after the end of the semester out into the real world.
Great, thank you so much. All of you, Alina, Kiana, Jarell, what a wonderful presentation, what a wonderful effort that you've put into making this idea come to fruition. I recall, you know, meeting with people, with students from the Frontiers of Justice group last fall, when the world was a completely different place than it is now. So we actually met at Lerner Hall and not over Zoom. But I remember having so many amazing and inspiring conversations with all the students and all of the ideas they had for how to do something that isn't right. I mean, what you're doing transcends a course or a seminar, right? Like, you're thinking really holistically about, you know, what you're learning in the course, but how you can actually make a difference in terms of advocacy and policy proposals and really working with community members as partners, as opposed to Columbia students who are trying to help community partners without actually really partnering and engaging and making sure that, you know, that everyone is all in and striving toward the same desired ends. So it's such a wonderful effort. And I think all of us faculty, staff, and alums are always floored by the initiative that our students take. So first, thank you so much for that. And I did just want to ask a question, because we do still have a little bit of time. Actually, we have a decent amount of time, so we could definitely have a nice conversation, but to just get the ball rolling, given Columbia and the core curriculum, it would be great if you could share more with us about the readings that you'll be doing in the course, because, you know, so much of what we do in the core curriculum is grounded in the readings of contemporary civilization and Lit Hum. So it would be great to think about kind of the through line from those readings to kind of the more contemporary readings and with an eye toward praxis of what you're reading in your course in Frontiers of Justice.
Alina, I'm relying on your expertise. I'll come after you, Alina.
Interrupt me, go for it. I think one thing I will say is we definitely wanted it to be a blend of disciplines simply because I think that would be the best way. We discussed this would be the best way to make sure that students from a variety of backgrounds could engage with the material. So a large part of the readings that we put into the course are, you know, backed by psychological research. So there are a lot of articles of psychological research going on. We also have philosophical texts. So I know that, for instance, in the first week, we had Kwame Anthony Appiah, his book, Lies That Bind, we assigned a few chapters. And so, you know, I'm gonna also defer back to Jarrell and Kiana here so they can add more, but it's really just a blend of various readings that have to do with the themes for the week. We also supplement it with a lot of current news articles. So constantly relying on The Atlantic, The New York Times, et cetera, for folks to engage with.
Yeah, I think so. That was great, Alina. I think so. The course is actually structured around the foundation of Yuri Bronfenbrenner's ecological model of human development. And it's actually a psychological study that explores how people develop based on environmental circumstances. So if you ever had the chance to see the circular diagram that he presented, he came up with a five systems theory approach that says that on the smallest level, the micro level, the individual is immediately influenced by the parent, the home environment that they're raised in. And if that structure isn't stable, then that person will go on to interact with the other layers in it, either positively or negatively. So this can be people who they go to school with. This can be friends in the neighborhood. This can be all of those kind of other social systems that help develop the child. But I think what's most important in that is the relationships that you form with the institutions you interact with, systems you interact with, and then the consequence of things that indirectly affect you. So if I can give you an example on the meso level of it, the way if my mother was to be laid off from work and as a child me not being able to work and compensate for my own self, then my mother being laid off would indirectly affect me, and that would affect the way that I'm developing as a child. So really, I just don't want to go into details, but the idea of is that before we can talk about community change and social change and the policy recommendation side of it, an individual will have to first understand how they can personally change in personal aspects of their own life and help those changes go into the reality of what we like to see in communities and so on. But I guess that's the foundational reading of the course. And then we also explore excerpts of Michelle Alexander's Jim Crow and other current texts. But I think what's most innovative about this course is we try not to rely so much on detailed readings. As you already know, most of the Columbia experience is based on academic articles. But I think what's most unique about it is that we have a number of media links, but preferably YouTube clips or TED style presentations. And I think that that helps people to engage with the materials or the course theme for that week in a little bit differently. Because some people are visual learners, some people read and attain information that way. But I think that the introduction of the media links and the wide use of them throughout the course is a new way for students to kind of engage with this new way of introducing justice related issues. And Jodine is on, so she may be able to.
So I would also say it's, What they've done so far was bring in professors and community members and put them in a hot seat and just threw questions at them. So it was, in a sense, they were unprepared for and couldn't give pat answers to the questions that they were asked. Like, is change and equity really possible to achieve, which Professor Yosef Saret got asked last week, and Professor Valerie Purdy-Vaughan, or Greenaway, the previous week, got asked, you know, well, what is it like when you're a professor at Columbia and you're a Black woman? Are there people saying to you, you know, no, you don't be, you're a sellout, or you're not enough of a professor? So these are the kind of questions that the professors get asked. But what I particularly appreciate about the course is that many of our students from the Justice and Education program that we teach in Sing Sing and at Taconic are now home and actively participating in the course. And so it's bringing together effectively the course that Jarrell started off in, bringing it from inside the walls to outside the walls. And even for those students who are still inside, we have their TED Talks as part of the curriculum. So it's really trying to bring together everything and everybody that's needed to work together for a really real understanding of what justice can look like. So we'll put it back to Kiana.
Thank you so much. No, I mean, I really have nothing else to add. Just to say, like, the diversity of the syllabus is something really exceptional. Like I said, I'm a senior and I've taken various classes, a lot centered on justice and the humanities. But I think, you know, as Jarrell said, having video and having, you know, peer-reviewed scientific literature in addition to an op-ed that, you know, someone who is very, you know, justice-oriented has wrote or who has direct experience with, you know, incarcerated or impacted populations. That's very unique. And I'm very grateful that Professor Downey and Professor Sword have given us this opportunity, or else I probably wouldn't have, you know, been so fortunate. So thank you.
And let me just, Professor Surrett is here, but Professor Ayanna Surrett, she keeps it real. She's a lawyer. She has direct experience. And so it's when we start to get into theoretical realms, she understands what it's like on the ground. And it's very, very important to have these kind of collaborative education where there's more than one teacher in the classroom. And just say one more thing. One student said the reason that he wanted to take the course is that he saw Angela Davis and Carl Dweck on the same syllabus. That has never happened to him before at Columbia. So.
And just to make sure I understand correctly, this course does satisfy a science requirement?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's incredible, because given the syllabus that you shared with us and how interdisciplinary it is in nature, it's terrific that students can also use this to satisfy a science requirement. I wish it had been the case when I was endeavoring to do so myself at Columbia. So thank you so very much for making science more open to us humanities people. Terrific. Do you have any, again, I can't believe it, we're actually running on time, a minute early. So would any of you wonderful Frontiers of Justice team members, do you have any parting words before we move on to our next speaker?
Maybe I just want to say I'm so excited about this, and hopefully the next cohort will be, you know, as lucky, and this seminar will be offered annually. But if anyone in the meanwhile wants to reach out to me, Alina, or Jarrell, we're here. We can share the syllabus, so we can kind of do like the readings together if that is of interest. But thank you so much, Beth, for having us.
Thanks, Beth.
Of course. Thank you so much to all of you for joining us and for your wonderful, passionate, and inspiring work. We're deeply grateful for you and for the initiative you've taken to really move this forward. I gotta say, when I met Jarrell last year, I was like, this is never gonna happen. I'm just kidding. I wasn't like that at all. But truly, I really am heartened by your efforts in pushing this forward. So congratulations, truly. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Our next speaker is Professor Damon J. Phillips from the Business School. He is the Lambert Family Professor of Social Enterprise. He received his PhD from Stanford University. Before joining Columbia in 2011, he was on the faculty of the University of Chicago Booth School of Business from 1998 to 2011. During the 2010 to 2011 academic year, he was a fellow at the Center for Advanced Study in Behavioral Sciences at Stanford University. Professor Phillips has expertise in social structural approaches to labor and product markets, entrepreneurship, innovation, organizational strategy and structure, as well as social network theory and analysis. His industry specialties are markets for professional services, law consulting and investment banking, and culture, particularly music industry. His 2013 acclaimed book, Shaping Jazz, is an innovative study of the emergence and evolution of the market for recorded jazz. In addition to publishing in top journals within management and sociology, Professor Phillips has been on the editorial board of the Administrative Science Quarterly, an associate editor with Management Science, and was a consulting editor at the American Journal of Sociology. Professor Phillips is a Phi Beta Kappa graduate from Morehouse College with a bachelor's degree in physics. He earned his first master's degree in aeronautics and astronautics from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and he earned a second master's degree in sociology from Stanford University. Before pursuing his PhD at Stanford, he worked as an engineer and researcher affiliated with the US Air Force and was an executive in a family-owned electronics manufacturing business. He enjoys spending time with his wife and two daughters, learning to play instruments and listening to music. And in addition to that, Professor Phillips also serves on the Holder Initiative's Faculty Steering Committee, as does our previous speaker, Professor Geraldine Downey. So with that, welcome so much, Professor Phillips, and I will hand it off to you.
Thank you very much, Beth. I was like, wow, that's quite an introduction, so I appreciate it. And also a shout out to Anissa as well. She's a student in one of my classes, so it's good to see her name on here as well. I'm gonna begin with a bit of a story. And then I'm going to try to share, do a share screen and share a short clip of video, which sort of explains what some of the things that we're doing over in the business school. But in terms of just the short story, it really, for me, this topic, and this is a great topic because it really follows what Geraldine was talking about. And she's been a huge influence in terms of what we are doing. The folks in Center for Justice are fantastic partners for us. For me, it begins when I was a teenager, and my father had a small business. It was a small tech manufacturing business in Florida. And this had about 25 employees. Some of those employees were people who were justice involved. They had been to prison and returning home from prison. And my father gave him work at the company. Now, it just so happens that they were some of the best employees there. And they were fantastic, both in just the quality of the work and the commitment to the job. Now, I was a teenager, so I was definitely much more self-centered than anything else and didn't pay much mind to sort of the larger sort of thing going on in the world, and the millions of Americans that are adversely impacted by our criminal justice system. That didn't really occur to me at the time. I was like most teenagers then. But let's fast forward to 2015. In 2015, the spring of 2015, in a way that has been a trend, which is considered this, which has continued this summer, you had the Freddie Gray incidents and the protests in Baltimore. And from that became or initiated a set of conversations that I started having. I had been in New York for a few years then. I lived in Chicago before New York and had been in New York for a few years. And becoming increasingly involved with things and started having these conversations with people in business leaders about what can be done. And and how could the business community in general, but in particular business school, how could we play a role? And that's what started what we call REAP. And REAP stands for the Reentry Acceleration Program. And on the what sort of behind this is just some statistics, which I have them on slides, but it's pretty easy to communicate. We have over 200 million people incarcerated at the moment. And that doesn't even come close to the people who are impacted, the families, people who are formerly incarcerated. There's a probation parole system. It's just massive. But on the people in prison, about 650 return and come home each year. And what really galvanized us in the business school is that most of those folks, most of that 650 are returning to prison. Now, why? There are a few reasons, but a big one is employment. A big one is that it's really difficult to get a job. It's, yes, some of it is being prepared for a job, but also there is a big stigma. And then when we thought about, well, what can we do as a business school? That is where we centered our efforts. So that's a little bit of the background. I was thinking that it might be good for me just to show a video which captures some of this. It's a 3-minute video. And then maybe Beth, we can either have a conversation about some of the lessons that we've learned or where we're going from here. I can share more of the background with it. So let me share my screen here.
The Reentry Acceleration Program, also called REAP, is Columbia Business School's response to the need for the business community to help people with criminal records, those who are formerly incarcerated, have better employment and entrepreneurship opportunities.
This past semester, I had the opportunity to teach Getting to Yes, which is a basic negotiation course. It was really great, especially having taken negotiations in a prior semester, to teach some of the same exact cases that I got to go through as a student to these students who are incarcerated. A lot of business school classes talk a lot about various types of disfranchised people, including formerly incarcerated people, but REAP provides us a really rare and important, a really powerful, actually, opportunity to work with those very people, to understand what their concerns are, to understand what we can do as future business leaders to empower them.
I think one key takeaway for me was that these are people who are just really, really smart. They have so many great skills, and it's just been a matter of unfortunate circumstances that have kind of put them where they are. But I think one thing that has been very inspiring for me was how forward-thinking they are, and the fact that they aren't letting the past and the things that have happened to them really impact how they think about the future. And so that means that they come to class very prepared. Business school students and MBAs particularly are really positioned to be able to create some really sustainable solutions to how we think about hiring formerly incarcerated people. These are individuals who will go on and they will be in positions at corporations who will have hiring decision power and decision-making power to be able to influence the strategies that these companies take when they're thinking about who they hire.
The Tamer Center was a huge factor in my deciding to come to Columbia Business School. It was really important to me to know that I would be supported in pursuing social justice work when I was here at Columbia, and there's really nothing like it at other business schools.
REAP has really cemented the work that I want to do post-business school. I'm constantly thinking about, as a participant or now an alum to REAP and CBS once I graduate, then how do I continue that advocacy? Whether it be from the hiring side or whether it's from even thinking about how companies invest their philanthropic dollars.
We now are developing a blueprint where we can be a thought leader and take this model to other universities and other business schools around the country who also want to engage in this large social problem that we are all trying to collectively solve.
Okay. That gives you a sense of it. And there are a few themes in there that I just wanted to end on. And if there are any other questions or dialogue after that, we can talk about that. But part of the logic behind the REAP program, and this is something which was based on something an alum was doing at the University of Virginia, who's on the faculty there, is that we are working to not only teach business skills in prisons where people are formerly incarcerated, but part of our mission is to help prepare and educate future business leaders. And we think that our impact will be as big as you can tell from the video, on the MBAs that are in their teaching will be equally big impact for them as it would be for others. But these are going to be decision makers and people who are in hiring decisions. So it's a program that we're very excited about. We've had about 100 MBA and executive MBA students do it so far since launching 3 years ago. I've been in it. We've touched about 250 people who are either currently or formerly incarcerated in that work. So it's for those of you who are in the business community, there is a lot we can do. So this is my call to action. There's a lot we can do. And this is just one example. If you want to join us, please do. That's just a little bit about what we do here.
So we do have a question, and we do have time for one question. Before saying, I would like to just thank you so much for that amazing presentation and the work you're doing. And as one of the students highlighted in the film, I too have been encouraged by the Tamer Center to think about attending Columbia Business School if they'll have me. So really, truly, the work you do at the Tamer Center is really inspiring as we think about how business can have positive impact on these matters of social justice. So truly, thank you so much for that. And the question I've received is, how does REAP mitigate hiring bias in corporations that ask for prior records?
So there's a few things that we do. So first, we work to try to convince employers, depending on where they are, but if they're in New York, there are ban the box regulations that at least will slow that down, and that they're not looking at records till the end if they need to look at them at all. And so some of this is not necessarily what Tamer Center does. There's some of it is a legal framework, but let's say that's not an operation. We work with partners who do workshops around that question in particular about how to hire. And really the focus is, well, if the person is qualified for the job, then the person is qualified for the job. And these, and to really make that assessment and to move forward with that. Now, if there's a reason for the job where the criminal background may be relevant, then okay, but that's rare. That's not the usual case. So first part of the answer is legal. And then the second is, yes, we do actively work on that. I would say some of it is working on helping employers. And again, we have partners who run workshops, particularly on that question. The last thing I'll say is that some of this is changing the narrative, and we're all involved with changing the narrative. And that's, I think, everyone's long-term goal, because that's when you're gonna see monumental change.
Wonderful, thank you so much, Professor Phillips, for making time for joining us today.
Thank you.
And your wonderful presentation. And we look forward to working with the Tamer Center as we tackle these issues.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Thank you. I appreciate
it. Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yes, thanks for having me.
Our next speaker is Imara Jones, Columbia College, 1994. Imara Jones, who is an Emmy and Peabody Award winner, is a journalist, intersectional news producer, and creator of Translash, which was featured in The Guardian's coverage of the 50th anniversary of the Stonewall Uprising. Imara is currently a Soros Equality Fellow and chaired the first ever UN high-level meeting on gender diversity. And with that, I would like to welcome Imara Jones.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for inviting me to this really important discussion. We have a limited amount of time, so I'm going to hit the key points of my talk, and hopefully we'll be able to get through it in such a manner that we'll have a little bit of time at the end for at least one or two questions, because I think dialogue is an essential part of making progress. I wanted to talk today about why trans rights and the inclusion of trans rights is especially essential for the fight for racial justice and for human rights and for equality. As a matter of fact, I don't believe that there's a coincidence that the fight for racial justice, which has surged again in the latest iteration of the Black Lives Matter movement and the conversation around trans rights in this country, the fact that they're happening at the same time is an accident. I believe that it is a consequence of history and points us into the direction of exactly where we need to go. And that's because since the end of the Civil War, we've made a fundamental approach in the fight for Black rights in this country by prioritizing some rights of Black people over others, namely the rights of Black men. And the thought and the belief and the approach was that as we generally began to gain more rights for members of our community, that those benefits would expand over time to everyone within our community. And I think that what we have seen in the intervening years is the fundamental failure for that approach. We've learned and we've seen that unless the rights of everyone are secured, that there are cracks and fissures that can be exploited that allow the rights of everyone to be rolled back. And therefore, the deliberate exclusion of LGBTQ people from the civil rights movement, namely, for example, through the exclusion of Bayard Rustin, is a fundamental error. And that error is also carried over to the LGBTQ movement, where Black and brown trans women were instrumental in starting the Stonewall Rebellion and creating the very first march that commemorated Stonewall, which eventually became the Pride March, which that march's anniversary would have been, or was rather, June of this year. So last year was the 50th anniversary of Stonewall, and this year was the 50th anniversary of the first march, both, as I mentioned, grounded and created by Black trans women. 4 short years later in 1973, there was a deliberate exclusion of pushing out Black and brown trans women from the movement that they created. And the thought was mainly by white gay men in the movement was the idea that the inclusion of Black and brown trans people would lead to a fundamental rejection, by the wider community of the rights of LGBTQ people overall. And I'm sad to say that in many ways, they were right. White gay men secured rights, constitutional rights, both in terms of sodomy laws and in terms of marriage before anyone else in our community, and were able to advance economically and elsewhere. And the sum total of this exclusion is the extreme marginalization of Black trans women, where Black trans women have the highest rates of poverty, the highest incidence of intimate partner violence, which is the leading cause of death for Black women overall, Black cis women overall, and Black trans women, the highest rates of educational exclusion, and across the board. And that twin marginalization, both in terms of race and gender identity, leads to and creates a cultural and a policy environment that is violent, that actually leads to physical violence against Black trans women. So for example, we've had the most violent levels in terms of the murder rate of Black trans women since 2016. As a matter of fact, this year, 2018, we are on track to exceed last year's record, and we passed that record this year in August. So this year could be the deadliest record in history, since we've been keeping records since the 1980s for Black trans women in this country. And so that twin marginalization underscores the fundamental failure of our approach to human rights and civil rights. And then we see that since Black trans people are, as because Black trans people are the most marginalized, then that marginalization, when you move out from our community to Black trans women, to Black men, to other LGBTQ people, lessens, but is still severe. And so what we're called to do in this moment is to actually invert and create an inverse approach to the way that we create human rights. That is to say, to create policies and ideas which underscore that everyone have to be brought along in this particular moment, that we need to center the most marginalized of people, that if we create policies and approaches and a cultural language which champion and uplift Black trans women, that we will create a world that uplifts everyone. And the most fascinating thing is that Black trans women are actually leaders in across so many fields when it comes to the ending of mass incarceration, ways to think differently about how we structure our economy, ways that we think differently about healthcare, ways that we think about cultural presentation. And as we begin to move forward, it's important that we champion, lift, and uplift those voices so that they can lead, so that we can have a fundamentally different approach to civil rights and human rights in this country, which centers everyone, including the leadership of Black trans women. So I'm actually going to stop there because I know that time is short, and to see if there are any questions or comments.
Thank you so much for sharing all of that. We're actually doing surprisingly well on time. So if there's anything more that you'd like to say, I, for one, would love to hear about any projects or initiatives that you're working on in terms of advocacy or developing policy proposals. And we definitely have time. So we'd love to hear about it.
Yeah, so generally speaking, I don't develop policy because my job as a journalist and a storyteller is to highlight those things and to point to different problems. So I'm not an advocate in that way, but I can point you to some really important levels or places that are doing advocacy. I think one important place is the Black Trans or the Trans Agenda for Liberation, which is put together by the Transgender Law Center this year. And it discusses 7 or 8 key pillars of policy and ways to rethink our society, where we can make sure that we advance the lives and livelihoods of Black trans people and Black trans women. There are ways in which Black trans people in Atlanta, through a project that is called SNAP, is working a lot on reimagining justice, reimagining in mass incarceration, looking at ways even to reimagine jails as spaces. So I would encourage people to look there as well. And also what I have written about is the fact that we can't end the epidemic of violence against Black trans women. And by the way, that word epidemic is not a word that I am using. It is a word that the American Medical Association used last year to label the incidence of violence against trans women in this country, specifically Black trans women, as an epidemic. There's no way that we can end that epidemic without looking at economic justice, because one of the things that I found in my research is that there's a high correlation between the marginalization of Black trans women economically and physical violence. And so to the degree that we can transform and think about holistic strategies that would end economic marginalization for trans women are all really important. Some of those will be familiar to people, such as universal basic income. Also the possibility that we need to have affirmative action for Black trans women, specifically in education and economics. And controversially, we should consider decriminalizing sex work as well, for a whole host of reasons, mainly because it would allow trans people to be able to access a whole host of government programs that people were not able to access now, which can help to lead out of poverty. So there are a lot of things that we can do across the board, and there are lots of ideas out there. As I mentioned, Transgender Law Center, the Trans Liberation Agenda, SNAPCO on ending mass incarceration, rethinking of those, and other ideas around economic justice.
I really picked up on what you were sharing about how there seems to be a tendency for certain subsets of a marginalized population to kind of like have movement and like get their rights and then forget about everyone else. And so, you know, and that's something that I think about that's been really top of mind as we're in this kind of frenetic election season of thinking about, you know, the suffragist movement was racist. So since you experienced this really firsthand, thinking about rights that have been secured, but not for trans women in particular, I'm just wondering what your thoughts are as a journalist and your story and as a storyteller of how you seek with the work you're doing to really kind of hold the line and make sure that these issues do stay top of mind until everyone gets a piece of the pie.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, I think I would also say that idea of people getting rights and forgetting about others, that's, as I said, that's led to a fundamental failure where we're in a moment of human rights crisis for so many communities across the United States because of the fundamental failure of that approach. So we have to rethink that in some fundamental ways. And so the way that I do that through my work is highlighting either through documentaries that we make on Translash, or we have a podcast, which I would encourage everyone to check out at translash.org/podcast. We have a podcast that comes out every 2 weeks where we take on various issues, the intersection of trans issues with immigration, the intersection of trans issues with the election, the intersection of trans issues with a whole host of public policy discussions. And I think that that's what's really important about my work is that I do look at the intersection of trans issues through a news lens, through a journalistic lens, so that we can reveal and point to and uncover the things that we need to do in order to change policy and make things better for everyone. So actually your question animates the entire scope of my work.
Terrific. I'm glad to hear that. And again, truly, thank you so much for taking the time to join us today and for all the important work you're doing. And we'll also share your podcast with all of our attendees because we want to make sure that people are learning from that as well. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful day. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye. And then our last speaker is Ian Manuel. Ian is a poet, activist, Starbucks upstander, and McDowell Fellow. Ian's poetry was featured in Bryan Stevenson's bestseller, Just Mercy. In 1990, Ian was living in Tampa in one of the poorest, most violent housing projects in the state. At 13, he was involved in a shooting, which left him one of the youngest prisoners condemned to die in prison in the United States. He was so young that he was put in solitary confinement, where he remained for the next 18 years. 10 years ago, the Equal Justice Initiative took on Ian's case as part of their fight to end excessive punishment for children, hoping to ban life without parole for children who were convicted of non-homicides. Ian was released after 26 years in prison. Since the release, he has spoken at NYU, Butler University, Columbia University, the School of Visual Arts, Nexus, and many prestigious colleges and organizations. He currently resides in Brooklyn, and completed his memoir for Penguin Random House entitled My Time Will Come. And with that, I would like to welcome Ian Manuel.
Thank you. Thank you, Elizabeth. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes, I can.
Great. I don't have enough time to go into depth of the entire story, but what I'd like to share with you guys today is about basically the injustice of solitary confinement, the unconstitutionality of incarcerating juveniles to life in prison without the possibility of parole, and share some of my poetry with you. I start by sharing some of my poetry. I wrote this poem called Every Time I Breathe when I was in solitary confinement after they took me out of my cell for 1 hour to watch PBS. In prison, they used PBS as a punishment. Let that sink in. Again, they use PBS as a punishment because prisoners like to watch sports and entertainment to get by in the day. But this particular day, it backfired on them because there was a documentary on called To Be Heard about three South Bronx teenagers who used poetry to express themselves and about the pain that they were going through in their life. I had only been exposed to written word poetry before. By me growing up in solitary confinement, you know, Langston Hughes, Maya Angelou, But to see slam poetry, it opened a whole new world to me. And I went, couldn't wait to go back to my cell, and I wrote this poem called Every Time I Breathe that I want to share with you guys. Now it says, every time I breathe, I feel the need to justify my existence, to take this moment that I'm living and enjoy every millisecond in it. My life and my struggles, not many can comprehend it. My desire for freedom burns like a sausage inside a skillet. Tomorrow isn't promised, so I'm thankful for this minute. Though in prison merely existing, it's like my life has been suspended. But that means it's temporary because I haven't been expelled. And I still got a chance as long as I can in and exhale every time I breathe. Every time I breathe, I'm thankful for the oxygen from the trees and little things like little bees that get overlooked until they sting. Every day I'm faced with obstacles that block the progress to my dreams, but the blockades only masquerades like costumes on Halloween. I've been through enough pain to make a sane man just scream, but instead, I take a deep breath and just breathe. Every time I breathe, the cosmos come out of my nostrils like particles of product coming out of your console. My soul is like a chihuahua you didn't include in your carpool. My lungs relax and collapse like a bottom sitting on a bar stool. Every time I breathe, I become an intergalactic being, stepping out of character like a chiropractor, snapping peas. I pray so many times, it's like I got arthritis in my knees. But I still get down and bow my head because I continue to believe that as long as I can breathe, God's going to make a change. And my circumstances, the only chance is for me to glorify his name. You don't know me, homie, but that's odds I've already overcame. So if praying works, but hurts, then I can stand a little pain. I want to end this part by thanking God for bringing me to these heights. And I make a promise to always honor and cherish this breath of life. Every time I breathe. Every time I breathe. Every time I breathe. And I composed that poem in solitary confinement around 2012, but how did I end up there? I ended up in prison because of a law that's still on the books in the state of Florida, where I happen to be right now vacationing, that says a child of any age indicted for a life and death felony shall be treated in every respect as if he were an adult. So there was no waiver hearing in my case. They direct filed me based on this law. So I didn't have all the protections afforded to most juveniles with the waiver hearing. I was just picked up from the juvenile detention center on August 17th, 1990 and taken to the Hillsborough County Jail. And, I found myself in an adult court, in an adult system, but still having the mind and the ideas and the imaginations of a child. I was subsequently convinced to plead guilty by my lawyer and my mom. And based on that guilty plea, I was sentenced to life without the possibility of parole. I'll never forget what the judge said. The judge said, Mr. Manuel, there was a statement made about giving you a second chance. However, sometimes there are no second chances. So for the crime of attempted murder, I sentence you to life. For the crime of robbery, I sentence you to life. For the crime of attempted armed robbery, I sentence you to 15 years. And for the other crime of attempted murder, I sentence you to life probation, to run consecutive to your life sentences. And the life probation is being imposed in case the Department of Corrections should, for whatever reason, ever release you. Well, thankfully, Brian Stevenson of the Equal Justice Initiative found me languishing in solitary confinement. I don't know if many of you guys have read his book, Just Mercy. but he talks about my case in there. And he talks about, you know, that juveniles are different. He took my case to the, a case similar to mine to the U.S. Supreme Court, and the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that it's unconstitutional to sentence a juvenile to life in prison without the possibility of parole. The state of Florida felt like that ruling didn't apply to me, so they appealed to the Florida Supreme Court trying to get the Graham decision not to apply to me, and then subsequently appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court, who thankfully didn't grant certiorari to hear their appeals. How Graham, their ideology was that because I had an attempted homicide, that the Graham decision didn't apply to me because it fell under the homicide statute. So I was taken back to court and re-sentenced in 2011 to 65 years in place of the life sentences that I had been given. You might see and find that shocking, but this is what's occurring all around the United States. States courts are so frustrated with federal courts telling them how to run their states that juveniles are being re-sentenced to 65 years, 99 years. I seen one case on the re-sentencing, the juvenile was sentenced to 200 years. And it's on us as an initiative, as a people, to do what we got to do to put people in office that elect these judges, and even at the state level, put judges in place that actually don't want to see children go to prison, because once you're in prison, you're subjected to all the rules of an adult. Except in certain instances, I couldn't even buy a pack of cigarettes. I don't smoke, but being that I was under 18, I want that to sink in. I couldn't buy a pack of cigarettes, but I was old enough to be sentenced to an adult sentence and placed in an adult prison. And if it wasn't for the Equal Justice Initiative and Brian Stevenson and my friend and victim Debbie Bagri, I would have languished in the Florida prison system for the rest of my life. I got out, was miraculously released November 10th, 2016, 2 days after Trump was elected. I was released from prison, and I got out and went through the Equal Justice Initiative reentry program. And I'm in New York now, where I just finished completing my memoir called My Time Will Come. And I want to share another poem with you based on that, and be open to any questions you guys might have. The poem, My Time Will Come, says, I promise you, the brunt of my oppression has a purpose, and this same person that you persecute will one day be worshipped. Though I stand before you bare-chested and shirtless, with my soul and emotions naked, just wanting to be nurtured. Yeah, despite the desperation, desertion, and hurting, my time gonna come. Though I composed this poem not knowing if I'll ever be able to perform it in an auditorium, I do it with the faith of a poet that believes he was born to do it, like an acorn caught up in a storm, flung from the branch where it was born. You can only hold me back for so long. My time will come. Despite the difficulties and disappointments, my determination remains undaunted. Though the waters of my tomorrows are deep and uncharted, the buoyance of my character will float unwavering towards them. Like a song written, yet unrecorded, my time gonna come. Though you wrap me in chains and sprayed me with chemical flames, and did all of the things you did to add to my pain, my circumstances will change. I believe this with the depths of my being, that as long as this world continues to spin, it cannot end until it's been enjoyed by Ian. Remember this day, because things won't always be this way. My time will come. My time will come. Against all conceivable odds, my time will come. And that book's available for pre-order right now from Penguin Random House or your favorite retailers. If you have any questions for me, Elizabeth, I'm open to answer them.
So I guess I have a two-part question. The first is, because it's related, someone submitted a question about your inspiring poem, Uncried Tears. Right. So I was wondering if you had any interest in sharing that, but if we don't have the time and if that isn't feasible, I could, of course, just ask you the question that is resulting from that poem.
Well, I don't know if I know the poem by heart, but I know the reason behind the poem. The experience beyond the poem is that I had so much pain trapped inside me from growing up in prison, from losing my mom, losing my dad, my brother. Everyone died. All of my immediate family died when I was in prison. To the extreme abuse I received at the hands of the guards in solitary confinement, being gassed, being beaten, being injected with psychotropic meds that I didn't need, and just being denied human contact for 18 consecutive years. I had a lot of pain inside, but in prison, and men in particular, we're taught not to cry. You know, we're taught not to to show our tears. So I came up with I found poetry as my therapy. And so I found a way to express the grief I was feeling in that poem by writing about the tears and the conscience in the conversation together. You know, about the tears and the conscience in the conversation together, and the conscience and the tears telling the conscience, like, let me out. This is the only way for you to heal, is for you to release me. And the conscience telling the tears, like, if I release you from bondage and actually let you out from behind the eyes, you're gonna dry up and die. And the tears telling the conscience, like, it's okay. I wanna see you triumph. If dying brings you to triumph, then dying's not such a disaster. So that's the gist behind that poem.
So then just as a follow-up to that, the question was posed by our dear friend and artisan residence, Christopher Wolfe. Wow. And he noted that poem in particular is such an inspiration for so many of the incarcerated students he teaches at Rikers. Right. So we were hoping that you might be able to lend some insight and advice for them as they strive to move forward in life and to develop as writers.
Yeah, so a couple things. Albert Einstein, one of the greatest thinkers of our time, of any generation, said, imagination is more important than knowledge. And I found that in solitary confinement, in prison, you have a lot of time on your hands to just dive in the depths of your imagination and bring it to life. Your innermost desires and thoughts, you're churning, you can bring them to life on the page. And so my recommendation would be to dive in the depths of your imagination, man, and bring all the things that you feel to life and on your paper. You're not being judged. That this is your truth. When you create something, you're bringing it out of the dark into the light. It's your light that you're bringing into the world. It's like giving birth to something new. And so I would just recommend that you stay true to who you are and use poetry as a therapy. I mean, that's what I did. Poetry was my therapy in doing my incarceration, and I leaned on it like a crutch, and it brought me so much joy. And to the highest stage. I mean, I performed poetry all over this country, man. And just thinking, I wrote most of these poems in solitary confinement when people told me I was worthless, you know. And here I am performing at Columbia. The School of the Visual Arts took my poetry and studied like 20 of my poems for an entire semester while I was still in solitary confinement. I mean, this is beyond me, but that shows you how powerful the imagination is. So I just tell people, particularly those in prison, to lean on their imagination and bring their truth into reality.
Thank you, Ian, so much for sharing your poetry and sharing your experiences with us today. Congratulations on your book.
Thank you. It's
amazing. Congratulations. Yeah. I will run out to, I won't say names, but I will run out to my favorite local bookstore and purchase it. Okay. And really, truly, thank you so much for allowing us to end our talks today on this incredibly uplifting note about the importance of resilience and resolve and being undaunted. So truly, thank you so much for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you soon and often.
Thank you, thank you. And I look forward to sharing my experiences with you guys often. All right, Elizabeth.
Thank you so much, Ian.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So with that ends our lightning talks for the day. Sorry, I'm just not sure what the view is right now. But in any case, hopefully you can hear me. I'm not sure if you can see me, but thank you so much for joining us for these lightning talks. We hope to do programming like this again with many people and short talks. But also, of course, we have longer fireside chats where we can actually take some of the discussions that we've started having today and actually dig a bit deeper into them in a longer format. Unfortunately, it seems like it'll be virtually for the foreseeable future, but we do hope that you will join us for those. And as Professor Harcourt said at the top of the program, we're extremely excited to host everyone on October 8th for our 2020 pre-election panel, with Attorney General Eric Holder, Vinita Gupta, Eugene Robinson, and Nate Silver. So we do hope that you'll join us for that. And we will be following up with all of you with updates and the information you would need to register for that upcoming program and our programming for the rest of the year. So with that, thank you so much for joining us, and enjoy the rest of your weekend. Thank you.